Okay, so I'm going to talk about Alternaria diseases of potato. And we commonly know that the key one is early blight or target spot. The descriptive names really refer to different parts of the disease caused by these Alternaria species. So early blight is the young stage and traditionally known caused by Alternaria solani. But there are similar species that have been shown to be key in other countries like Brazil and North Africa and Europe, where they've now genetically split Alternaria solani into these other couple of species names. It's not so important in Australia, although it probably means, as I've been finding with a lot of stuff in disease pathology, the more genetics people look at, the more they split species up. And it's quite possible there are other species associated with target spot disease and early blight. And that early blight refers to that blighting of young plants. So we don't see that so much. Really, our main issue is with target spot as a disease coming in later into the crop and prematurely senescing the crop. So. And that's due to the fact that these Alternaria species produce toxins that can actually affect the plant and then cause this defoliation or senescence. So the conditions that favour these diseases and life cycles, hot, dry conditions with extended wet periods. And the key one to mention is this greater than 8 hours of leaf wetness, which is required for infection. So when we come to looking at management options later on, need to think about that leaf wetness that's required. Obviously with wet weather conditions, it's going to be more difficult to have any influence on that, but there are things you can do at other times with irrigation scheduling and timing of sprays, for example. Stressed crops are more susceptible, particularly if there's other physical damage, things like rain, heavy rain, hail, wind, all of those things that damage the foliage will enable the Alternaria species to get in a lot more easily. Water stress, and so again, with those dry conditions where if you're not irrigating frequently enough, those dry conditions stress the plant, and then when the plants are wet, they're more susceptible. And finally, low foliar nitrogen. And again, that tends to occur as you're finishing the crop off. So if you've still got a lot of tubers to fill and the nitrogen starts to run out, then the Alternaria infection, the target spot infection, can impact on finishing those crops off or getting enough photoassimilates to get those tubers filled. It's what we call a polycyclic fungus, and that means that it doesn't just sort of come in and cause the disease once. Actually, the life cycle goes around and around, so you get secondary infections, and each time the inoculum builds up, you can get more and more disease under favourable conditions. So that in some years, like last year in the Central West, you probably had those conditions where the disease went through several cycles and managed to build up to an extent where it really knocked around crops before they were due to senesce. It survives, this fungus or these fungi survive as saprophytes in the soil and on plant debris. And they're also carried on tubers and volunteers. So probably not such a big deal with tubers, given that a lot of people would probably grade their tubers before they planted them. But certainly volunteers can be a way that the disease can persist from year to year outside of potato production. And some varieties are more susceptible. There's a common term. There's no real resistance to this disease, but we talk about some varieties being moderately resistant or moderately susceptible, but under extreme conditions, the weather conditions favourable for the disease, it probably wouldn't really matter too much. The fact is that the disease will progress. Here's some images, the typical target spot lesions on a leaf. This middle picture shows you the spores of the Alternaria solani with the what they call a beak, this long thing here at the end, and Alternaria alternata being the other species that seems to be becoming more prominent around the world, is what we call a small spored Alternaria species. And unfortunately, they produce lots and lots of those spores. And you can see they're kind of brown in colour, and that tells you that the spores have got melanin in them, which makes them resilient to ultraviolet light, so that they can actually survive a little bit more than other types of fungi, like some of the mildews and the like, when there's sunny, bright conditions. So it just means that these things can survive a little bit better under those under the sunlight. So brown leaf spot is really part of this disease complex, if you like, in that this Alternaria alternata, being one of these smaller spored species of Alternaria, has always been around, but in more recent years, it seems to be becoming more prominent, and we don't really know why. Again, Alternaria alternata as a fungal species, again, is a pathogen complex. So we don't really know whether there's been new strains introduced into Australia, or some strains of Alternaria alternata have just adapted a little bit more. And as I'll go on to talk in the next few points, there are some pertinent points about it that we need to consider. It often occurs with target spots. So you'll always find, if you look under a microscope at those target spot lesions, the different types of spore, the long beak spores and these little sort of rounder spores of the alternata. It was often thought to be a secondary invader, but I'm reading reports, and there's one from China where it's the main cause of target spot. And certainly the term brown leaf spot was coined about 20 years ago, where they started to find that it was, in a sense, a separate disease. But as I said, it's similar to Alternaria solani and occurs quite often together with it. So we just need to remember that quite often when we talk about target spot, we're probably talking about both Alternaria solani and Alternaria alternata. It appears to be more difficult to manage with fungicides. Now, I first came across this a few years ago when I was talking to some pathologists from the UK who mentioned it to me. And at that stage, I wasn't really doing any work in potatoes, so I kind of just put it in my memory and didn't think too much about it. But I had a call last year from New Zealand for some growers around Pukekohe, and they found the same thing, that they were having a lot more trouble controlling it. And it would seem that there's some issues with fungicide resistance, or what we probably more correctly term decreased sensitivity to fungicides. And this happens in all microorganisms. So the more you put the same chemicals on, the more chance there is of finding that odd mutant in the population that can tolerate a bit more of it. And tolerance to mancozeb, which surprised the hell out of me when I read it just recently, was something that's quite new. So that one does worry me a bit because mancozeb, being a multi-site activity, is reported to, because it acts on different sites in the fungus, is much, much lower chance of resistance. But there are now reports of it. One of the group threes, there seems to be some resistance and cross resistance, which is pretty weird. With no fitness penalty, that means that quite often when that mutant in the population has decreased sensitivity to a fungicide, it usually means that the mutations that are in that particular organism make it less fit to survive. And you find that, for example, in rovural iperidione, that group of chemicals, quite often with resistance to fungicides, to fungi like botrytis, if you stop using the chemical, that group of organisms that are resistant die off in the population. They're not as fit, if you like, to survive. So it's one of those issues where, in this case, there doesn't seem to be any fitness penalty when these sorts of tolerances develop. The thought is that what these things do, which I again find quite fascinating because it's more similar to what bacterial organisms do when they become less sensitive to things, they actually export the fungicide back out of the cell. So in this case, they found that there's genes that are switched on in the Alternaria fungus that actually push the fungicide back out again. Or at least the breakdown product of something like mancozeb. Other studies in the US showed a decreased sensitivity to the strobilurins, the group 11s, the zoxystrobin, but not to all of the SDHIs, so that's the group 7. So, for example, they found boscalid became less efficacious in controlling it, but not fluoropyram. So there's differences in the group 7s in terms of how they work. And there was also some work that showed that I think it was pyroclostrobin in the strobilurins was less affected, at least in that particular study. There's been other studies since that shows that all the strobilurins have lost some sensitivity. So that's a concern, I guess, for us, because we don't really know the status of our Alternaria species in Australia at the moment. So we'll go on to some management strategies, and I'll reflect back on a lot of the comments that I made earlier. So disease-free seed, so using certified seed obviously is important, and making sure that any rots that you see within that, any seed at all that you're planting are culled out prior to planting. A less susceptible variety choice if possible. There's not a lot of good information on this, and it's really probably something that you're going to have to figure out on your farm if you can actually find a variety that's suitable to you that seems to be less susceptible to it. Most of the international literature that I've looked at gives you these sort of vague terms of, you know, moderately tolerant at best. So there's no real resistance. Crop rotation and avoiding solanaceous crops and solanaceous weeds, along with volunteers, obviously. And that goes with crop debris. And I've got a question mark here. I've read a lot about and heard promotion of enhanced residue breakdown products using microbials. I've not done any work myself on this, but I think that's something that would be worth trialing at some point to see whether or not by spraying these microbial products on the crop residue and then ploughing them in, whether you're getting quicker breakdown. That's something I'm not sort of prepared to say that's a definite. But as I said, there are people promoting products that are supposed to do that. Okay, so having that Goldilocks effect with the nitrogen fertilizer, so you're not actually over-fertilizing, but then you're not going to run out of nitrogen in the crop before your tubers have got to a stage where you're happy with their size before the crop senesces, and that's a key thing that, again, will be varietal dependent. Scheduling irrigation to avoid moisture stress in long periods of leaf wetness. So as I talked about that 8 hours of leaf wetness required for infection. At some stages, maybe you might want to irrigate earlier in the day so that the crop can dry out before the evening. So you're not going to have this period of time where the crop's susceptible having wet leaves through the evening. So that might be another strategy you might want to utilize. Using preventative fungicides, as I said, there's a big question mark about mancozeb. I don't know whether that is a problem in Australia as yet, but certainly reading from that overseas report, which was only from 2 years ago, whether that's something that is a major issue or not. The anecdotal thing, as I said, from the UK and from New Zealand, where they would have products like Mancozeb in their programs, and they're finding it very difficult to control target spot. So that's something that we need to consider more. And scheduling prior to weather events. So whether there's any way you can sort of look, I mean, I know the weather we've just had in the last day in eastern Australia was predicted. And so whether if you had a crop that you get a spray on prior to the weather event occurring would give you some, I guess, more protection against the development of the disease. There was work done, and again, this is going back over 25 years ago, empirical disease prediction models that have been developed, which are regionally based. And so they look at the climate and weather factors and predict whether or not you're going to have a problem. And it's sort of an accumulation thing. So it might be through the season, you'd be accumulating sort of wet days or conditions that are conducive to the disease over a period of time, and then decide when to put your first spray on. I don't know that that's something that's really going to be relevant here in Australia. And the other thing about it is a lot of those models were developed before the development of better fungicides. So it was before we had a lot of the better group 7 and group 11 fungicides that we have now. So it was really a protective spray strategy that was being used. But it is something that if you are logging weather data, you could quite easily try to relate that back to disease development on your own farm. So if you're looking at a lot of those things, not just for this disease, but for a range of different diseases, it's something that builds up a set of data that you can historically look back and as you're monitoring your crops, look to see where the disease starts to develop and adjust your spray strategies accordingly in the future. I've put a slide here just with all the different products that have registration for target spot. And as Marc pointed out to me, that virtually all the labels will just talk about Alternaria solani. So you're really kind of limited in that respect. But at the same time, it's Alternaria. It's the same genus of fungus there. You'll probably always have Alternaria solani if you're seeing target spot lesions. Unless things have grossly changed in the time I haven't been looking at crops, but you've got your copper products, your dithiocarbamates, your chlorothalonil, and then you've got, as I mentioned, the group twos, the iprodione and prisimidone. So it's really having a spray program that incorporates as many of those sorts of different activity groups as possible, making sure you've got protectants in the mix as much as possible. So you're not just relying on the one systemic fungicide, say like a group 11 azoxystrobin. So you've got quite a suite of products there available. As I said, it really comes back to timing your products so that you're not sort of allowing the disease to really get away from you. And I guess hoping the weather is not as against you as perhaps it was last year and possibly even again this year with summer rainfall. And finally, just before we do go into some questions, it's important to remember that diseases don't just occur on their own. So this is an early dying crop suffering from early dying, and that'll be a future webinar, I think, that might be worth investigating, but you know, senescing crops are going to be susceptible to all diseases, and so you'll probably find Alternaria in amongst this, but in this case it wasn't the primary cause of the problem. it's a verticillium nematode problem that's caused this particular one. So it probably, as an old diagnostic plant pathologist, I guess, makes me say, just be careful. Don't always assume just by looking at a crop that you know exactly what the disease is. Maybe you need to send it off to a lab to get confirmed as well. So that finishes my short presentation, and I guess we'll take any questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Len. I just remind people that if they can always just speak out your question, and with this, we should be right to be able to hear you as long as you make sure you turn on your microphone. If there's a few questions on and you want to, you can use the reaction button in the, on Zoom and select the hand up function, and that'll at least know who to go to. We've already had a couple of questions for Len. Could the reduced tolerance to mancozeb be associated with low soil and plant tissue magnesium?
I think what I was reading was that it was really the fact that the fungus had adapted in a way that basically pushed the product back away. So it wasn't toxic any longer. It was actually being shunted outside of the fungus cells. So, and look, this is something I read recently, and it's a fairly recent publication. So it's quite a controversial topic to talk about resistance or decreased sensitivity in the dithiocarbamate group. But it looked quite convincing. So I think the mechanism they talked about sounded and looked pretty convincing based on the data that they presented. It was from China, and I don't know the researchers, but having said that, it's been through a peer review process. So I can't really, on the face of it, doubt it. But it would be interesting to do some testing. You could do that sort of testing in the laboratory to determine whether or not that decreased sensitivity is more widespread than just in places like China. And it does match up with that anecdotal stuff I mentioned about the researchers in the UK and in New Zealand talking about problems with controlling target spot.
Just quickly on that, Len, would you expect any difference or help from Mitteram, like Polyram? Very, I know you're not an ag chem guy, but.
Look, I think it's possible that, all the dithiocarbamates I mentioned in that slide there, there's about four of them, aren't there? There's mancozeb, zineb, Mitteram, and I don't think you've got antracoal for this one, but anyway, you've got three, and then you've got chlorothalonil, which is a bit different. So it's possible, the paper I read only talked about mancozeb, but zineb and polyram do act very similarly. So I'm not sure. I wouldn't like to say. More questions than answers.
Next question is there any advantage to know if alternata is the dominant species? And if so, how does the control strategy change?
Well, I think it's something that probably does require more effort in Australia to determine how important the alternata strain is and how similar they are around the country, whether it's all the same thing or not. How does the control strategies change? Well, as I mentioned, that paper from China was talking about alternata when they talked about the mancozeb tolerance. So it may well be that the solanite alternaria doesn't have the same decreased sensitivity to the dithiocarbamates because it was only reporting on alternata. So I think it's one of those things where there's a lot we don't know. But I'm just putting it out there.
Another question, has any work been done to determine the impact of outer plants, the ones that are stressed on the outer, say, outer part of a pivot, are the primal cause for pathogen attack. And every second planter pass has outer plants without fertilizer, for instance.
Yeah, well, I think there's a couple of issues there because I talked about the Alternaria being polycyclic. So if they're more stressed and they are the first to get infected, then the fungus will then move into further into the crop, you know, prevailing wind, it's spread by wind, rain. So it's going to spread from those stressed plants that if they're the first to get infected. And remember too that other diseases like tomato spotted wilt virus, quite often the plants around the edge are the first to get infected as well. So again, remembering that when plants get infected with, say, a virus, they are more susceptible to other diseases as well. So there's that factor that both your insects that vector diseases are going to probably hit those outer plants first, and then it can hop into the rest of your crop.
This is the last one on the chat, is the use of copper products mostly aimed to dry up the humid microclimate underneath the plant canopy, or is it another method that the copper products are used to fight early blight? And from the questioner's experience, copper products are not widely used, and maybe they should be in addition to be used.
Yeah, so copper is a pretty good fungicide, as we know. It also suppresses bacterial diseases, so it's quite a useful product as a good protectant. And some other chemicals are co-formulated with copper, or you can actually combine them as a way of improving the or decreasing the chance of resistance developing to those other products. So I think it does have a place. It's probably like most of the protectants, they're there just to help suppress disease. They're not going to control it. It's really just as a means to try and bring down the numbers. So it's really, I think the take-home point is, you know, using integrated strategies, making sure your carryover inoculum is low, making sure that you time your irrigation so you prevent stress. So I'd be looking at those points I put on that slide and trying to incorporate all of those strategies and in terms of protectants, copper is one of the protectants. Sometimes I think there's even products co-formulated with mancozeb. So I'd see it as just another tool that you can use in the preventative strategy to keep the inoculum levels low.
Does anyone else have any other questions of Len?